Shalom, everyone. I'd like to thank you for joining us in our tonight's Torah weekly class. I'd like to inform you that we are a bit delayed, so we apologize, but we will begin our broadcast shortly, so please stand by. Shalom, everyone. I'd like to thank you again for joining us online for tonight's Torah weekly class. We apologize again for the delay, but we will begin our broadcast here shortly, so please stand by. That's it. We need to go live. Almost. We got only half everybody up there. You're gonna stand, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, we have Richard McComb. Excuse me. That was not supposed to go live. Actually, he's in the chat room, so he's okay. Zoom in tight. And go ahead and center him. That's good. That's good. Perfect. Okay. Here we go, live in 3, 2.
Well, shalom aleichem.
Aleichem shalom.
We are so happy to be able to come into your home on the internet. Hallelujah. We are also working on a way to come into your home on the radio. And it looks like our first broadcast is going to be Sunday at 4 p.m. from 4 to 5 on Radio 1120. The Bridge here in Austin, Texas. So we're excited about that. Got a couple of people that would listen to it if it was on the radio, couldn't listen to it on the internet. So that's good. So we're going to have a Sunday from 4 to 5. It's called Chapter and Verse. And we're going to be talking about what the Bible actually says about topics that seem to be, generally speaking, misunderstood. So we're going to start off with taking a look at the prophetic nature of the holy days in regard to the coming of Messiah. So I think that'll be an exciting study, and we'll have some other topics to talk about as the series proceeds. We're going to be on every Sunday for 1 hour. Anybody that's interested in having your business promoted on our website as a sponsor, if you'll let us know, just send an email to what's the email address there, Lucifina?
Free.
Oh yeah, Keep It Free. It's the fundraiser is called Keep It Free, and we're going to be having you can email us at free@tzion.org, and we'll be happy to hear of your intent or desire to help sponsor this radio program. So, with that in mind, I think we'll have a word of prayer before we start our Bible study. And please take Wirecast full screen. All right. Now we're going to have a little prayer before we get into the Word. Avinu Malkeinu, our Father, our King, we are here tonight to study your word. There are lots of empty chairs, Lord. I ask you to anoint me to teach them. Those angels sitting in those chairs need to hear your word too, Lord. And I just ask you to cause me to have the anointing to fly up in faces and help people understand and give them grace and strength and understanding as they study tonight. There are some people here that are supposed to be here that are not here yet. We ask you, Lord, that they would receive the anointing to study with us as we move on into our studies. And, Lord, I ask you to just cause all the listeners who are online to be able to receive good food from the teaching tonight. So I want everybody to repeat after me. Father, I'm hungry.
Father, I'm hungry.
I ask you for good food to eat from heaven.
I ask you for good food.
And I'm thirsty, Lord.
And I'm thirsty, Lord.
I ask you for living water from heaven.
I ask you for living water from heaven.
That'll help me to have enough to give to others.
To help me have enough to give to others.
In the name of Messiah Yeshua.
Messiah Yeshua.
Amen. Baruch Hashem. Tonight's Torah study starts off in Numbers chapter 8, beginning in verse 1. Of course, it always starts essentially the same way. We have, Vaydaber Yahweh el Moshe Lemor, the word of Yahweh to Moses saying, Daber el Aharon. And that would be literally understood, word to Aaron. And Amarta. And you say, now I want to break this verb down here, so if I could get our programmer to get the screen set up so that the highlighted part of my text is pretty big. We'll pretty much fill the area available.
Yes, my computer's lagging a bit.
Oh, the computer's lagging. Yeah. My computer's lagging?
No, mine.
Yours.
My computer's lagging.
Well, maybe you should light a fire under it. And that's taken care of, so I can put that back down. Your window's not full again. We've been having a lot of allergies in Austin with heavy mold, and a lot of grass pollens are flying everywhere because we've had so much rain. And I got out and mowed the grass yesterday, and I got a face full of pollen, grass pollen, and mold, and my nose is a little bit stuffy this evening. So I don't think I have any of the medications that I usually use to help me with that whenever that happens. But I will probably bring some up here for next time. I learned the first time through. How are we coming? Just have some patience.
Yeah.
We'll get it here in just a minute. Well, we're going to restart our computer, so please, all of you, come back after just a couple of minutes and see if we're back on. So sorry about that, but we are going to try to fix this problem so that you can be able to receive more of the teaching that we're going to do tonight. You have to actually look at the Hebrew words in order to get these teachings, so I'm going to see what we can do to get the computer to working correctly. Just pray for us that we'll get it as we work on it here, and I know that the Lord will be with us, and you'll get to learn these lessons. Amen? Come back after we reboot.
Yes, give us about 5 minutes. Thank you. Okay, we apologize for the delay, but we're back online now.
Yay!
There we go, in three.
At last. Well, I'm sorry it's taken so long, but it looks like we're back online. Bring up my Bible and see if you can see it there. There it is. Well, we start off again in Numbers chapter 8, verse 1. Vaydaber Yahweh el Moshe Lemor. The word of Yahweh to Moses, saying. In verse 2, if you can bring that highlighted section up big on your screen, I would appreciate it. He says, Daber el Aharon, and say unto him, Zemarta Elohim Haalotka, when you are lighting the lamps, Nerot, lamps, El Mul Pnei Hamanorah. So That means that literally that are on the face of the menorah. And it says, he shall give light shall give light to seven lamps. The seven lamps that are on the menorah will give light. I want to talk about the verb that's highlighted. Can you bring it up a little bigger?
Sure.
That was a high level of confidence. Thank you very much.
You're very welcome. it's a tone of concentration, that's what it is.
I'll give it, there we go. Now you can see it. And it says the amarta. Now the in the front of it makes this a vav conversive, which means the tense of its happening is going to be reversed. If it's completed tense, it's going to be changed to incomplete. Or if it's incomplete tense, it's going to be changed back to completed tense. So the part of it that tells what the tense is this, in this case, the top. It's the pronoun, third person pronoun, it's second person pronoun, you. First person pronoun, you. Okay, so, and you say, now, this is a completed verb, and you makes it a more confirmed completed verb. However, the vav in front is the vav conversive part, and that reverses the tense of it. Now, I know some of you don't know much about language or tenses or verbs or whatever, but it's certainly something well worth learning if you're going to read Hebrew. So this is a completed form with the vav conversive, meaning that it's an incomplete form. And you will say unto him. So this first part of this verse reads, the word unto Aaron, word unto Aaron, and you say unto him, and this is a future tense occurrence that hadn't happened yet while he's speaking. And you say unto him, Behaalotekha. Now this is the word in. This is a mess up, sorry. That part. That is the direct object, the. It turns it into a causative action. So in lighting you, the you on the end of this one is...
There's nothing in there about lighting.
It means to go up, which implies that it may be lit.
Bingo.
So when you cause to go up, and here the ha on the end of it is the pronoun he this time, or you rather, the first person singular. So Behaalotekha, when you cause the going up, lamp, anything that's glistening or you could say burning. We have a Sabbath prayer where we say, Baruch Ata Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam Asher Kichanu B'mitzvotav V'tzivanu. Now I can't remember the word. To... The Hadlik Ner Shel Shabbat. So lahad then means to kindle, to light them, set them ablaze. So here, this is not the lahad ligner that we have in our Sabbath blessings, but it is a causing to go up. And it's the lamps that are causing to go up, so therefore we know that they're being lit because of the context. And it says El Mul Panay. El Mul Panay.
Over against. Well, huh? Against is correct, but against the face. It doesn't even say face.
Well, Hebrew is very conceptual. And oftentimes what they're wanting to say in English isn't there. So they have to make an adjustment in their understanding of these Hebrew words in order for it to make more sense to us as English readers. And here, to say that it's over against the face of the menorah, that doesn't really make much sense in English, but it makes perfect sense in Hebrew. So that it's actually telling us that these nerot, these candles up here on this top line, the nerot, the candles, when they are being caused to ascend, to be burned up, that it's to the, this is hard to translate right here, okay? But they've got it close enough that you can get the point of it. But it's really over against the face of the menorah. In other words, the candles are, they had reflectors on them, okay?
Yeah.
And they wanted these reflectors facing forward like the face of the menorah so that the light goes out in front of it into the area where it's needed. So, Mul Panay HaMenorah, as the lighting of these lamps is going to be over against the face of the candlestick, the menorah, Vayiru, and it shall, and he shall, this is the pronoun he, and this is a future tense, is not currently doing it, because the pronoun he is at the beginning of the word. There's not a vav conversi, so it doesn't change it back to a completed form. So this is an incompleted form. It's going to be done shortly, maybe. Here's the sign of the object, plural, because of the u on the end of the candle. And that is a incompleted form. He will give lights, plural. Shivat, which is seven, Hanerot, seven of the lamps. Now, we're not going to be studying Hebrew very long here, so those of you that are getting a little tired, say, let's go on in a minute. We'll get there. Just stick with me here. Verse 3, Vayas, and it means... And he did. Now this has got the pronoun at the beginning of the verb. So that means it's a incompleted form. He will and he will do. But because of the vav conversive at the beginning, it reverses it back to a completed form. And so it says, and he did. Ken means so. Or as Aaron, El Mul Panay HaMenorot. So he also, Aaron, set these candles against the face just as God had instructed him to. He lighted Allah, and he caused to ascend, Nerot, the flame, if you will, of the candles, just as which Siva commanded Yahweh et Moshe. So Moses did what God told him to do, commanded Aaron how he wanted the lights to shine on the off of the menorah, where the light was coming forward with the face of the candlesticks. And it says Aaron did as he was instructed or commanded by Yahweh and through Moses. Vazot Maaseh, and this is the work of HaMenorah, the candlestick. And that's going to talk about how the candlestick was made now. Miksha means literally beaten.
Are you sure?
That's what it said here.
Can you look it up? I found more places where it meant it was a single piece.
This says feminine of rounded work molded by hammering. Beaten,
okay,
essentially out of one piece.
Yeah, down below it says whole piece. Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah, out of one piece, yeah.
So that's the essential meaning of this word. Notice that this isn't really a verb here, beaten. It's more of a adverb. Is telling you how it was formed by being beaten rather than beating, which would be a verb. It's a description or an adverbial description of how the menorah was formed. And it's about time we had some visitors show up. Visitors, you're members, don't be visitors. Visitors get to come like you don't know. I'm just joking.
I object in the name of my
y'all prayer. Forgive me online. I just have to give somebody a hard time.
Don't mind skipping a little closer.
You gave blood again today?
I had plasma.
I don't see you, Miss Olivia. There you are. Okay.
She's hiding.
So this candle, then, was of beaten gold, made out of a single piece of gold. There's the word gold, zahav. Ad, yarecha, literally yarecha, means soft shaft. Now, the imagery of this is unmistakable, but it normally has to do with male gender. And it's describing it as a column or a pillar. And of course, you don't need much help in figuring out what that's talking about. So the shaft thereof and to the flowers. Pircha, flowers. How would you say flowers in modern Hebrew?
Birka. That means curtain.
It also means flowers. I can verify it if I was online. I'm not online now. Okay, so this is going to be the flowers of the miksha, beaten work. Again, here's that same word, miksha, beaten gold. So it's beaten gold, and to the shaft of the flowers, it's beaten work. Beaten work is he. Who means he in Hebrew? So this is talking about the work of the candlestick. This work was parochet miksha, which was beaten gold, is he. And then you continue on. And it's the grammar in Hebrew is so much different from English that oftentimes you'll find the verbs and the nouns swapped. from what we would use them in Hebrew. How many of you have seen the movie Star Wars? Everybody, most people raise their hands. Okay. Well, Jabba the Hutt, no, not Jabba the Hutt, Yoda. Yoda, the Jedi, always spoke with his verbs and nouns swapped.
Yeah.
Now, I wonder where they got that. They got it from Hebrew. There are a lot of other things that I see in that movie that's Hebrew. So, Moses made the candlestick. It wasn't actually Moses that made it. I'd like to point that out to you. But his workers that God had anointed to do the work of these furnishings for the holy place, they were the ones who had the skills that God gave them for making all these things. Mm-hmm. And so it wasn't actually Moses who did it, but Moses had the bottom line responsibility for their making them according to the plan that God showed him in the heavens. So that's why it says Moses, so that the, according to the pattern, which right here on this thing, kamaraet, which was, let me just look at that word, maraet, it means a view, the appearance of the thing. And so he says, according to the appearance of it, when he was shown in the heavenly, you know, up on the mountain, he was shown these things, and he made them according to the pattern. This is called pattern, but it's the actual, according to the appearance which Yahweh had showed him. So Moses made the menorah. So the menorah is a pretty important part of the Holy of Holies, holy place. It wasn't actually in the Holy of Holies. It was in the holy place just outside the parochet, which is the curtain in the holy place, dividing the holy place and the Holy of Holies. So Moses made these things according to the plan that God had given him. And we're going to go down to the next verse. And the word of Yahweh to Moses say, like I say, this is the most common phrase in the Bible because the Torah uses it repeatedly all the way through, showing who was doing the directing here. It was God directing Moses, directing Aaron, directing the Levites, directing the other workmen who were busy about making all these signs. And Yahweh spoke unto Moses saying, the word of Yahweh to Moses, Kach et alivim, take the Levi, mitok, from the midst of B'nai Israel, the children of Israel, v'tiharta, and you cleanse them. You cleanse them. Continuing on the next verse. The ko, and the ko means literally, and so, so here, it can also mean, and so you shall do, or whatever. So this is, and so you do, or make, to them, to cleanse them and sprinkle them upon them, mehatat, waters of purifying, and let them be shaved over all of their flesh, and let them keep su, let them wash their clothes. Kipsu is where you're washing something beside yourself. Or chatz would be where you're washing your own hands. Did you ever call me up, John?
Yeah. Commentary says that the waters of purification were, the waters of purification, commentary says the waters of purification were, they had the ashes of the red heifer in it.
Right. That's good.
So they say that those ashes for a long time.
So this water with the ashes of the red heifer, whatever, red heifer, these are what was used to cleanse the Levites. And isn't it interesting that they had to use the ashes of a dead cow that was used to make the water of purification? And it's also interesting that whoever used the water, we find this in the Torah in another section, that whoever used the waters of purification to cleanse someone who was not clean, they become unclean. Isn't that interesting?
Wait, how's that again?
Whoever sprinkles the water of purification on someone who is unclean, that person who did the sprinkling becomes unclean.
Oh.
Isn't that interesting?
Well, then how's anybody ever going to get purified?
Well, the instructions say that at evening he will become clean.
Yeah.
But he's unclean right after he does the sprinkling of the
water.
Oh,
I get it. Okay.
So here we see the work of this sprinkling of the waters of purification. It's an incredibly interesting subject, and it's kind of hard to figure it out in a natural sense why it would work. But it works because God says it works. God's the one that built the rules for cleansing, and Moses and the Kohanim and the Levites all operated according to the instructions given to them by Moses in the mountain. And then it says, let them kibasu. Kibasu means literally, let them wash. They're going to wash something. They're not washing themselves. They're washing something. What is it they're washing? Vigdehem, their clothes. Do clothes have any power to cleanse themselves?
No.
So it takes the work of the human instrument to use water and a cleansing agent to cause the clothes to become clean. Now, I was looking to see, okay, they had to cut the hair, to shave the hair from all of their flesh, and then let them wash their clothes and so make themselves clean. So this doesn't indicate that the Levites or Kohanim are supposed to wash themselves. But it's interesting to note this. Then let them take a bullock, ben bakar, a son, a child of the herd, of as a meat offering, min chato, with his meat offering, excuse me, and minchato, and his offering. Solet means fine flour, kind of like cake flour. You know how cake flour is a much finer flour than like bread flour? I guess you never baked bread and cake or anything like that. If you check cake flour, just mark that in the grocery store, open it up, you'll find out it's ultra fine, like dust. And it makes a very fine, light cake. Whereas bread dough is much coarser, and it's going to be more texture-ish. Has more texture to it. And so the soylent is going to be mingled with oil, bashamin. It's interesting that oil, shaman, is olive oil, and that what is the substance that's poured on top of the priest who is offering up offerings to God?
Shaman.
It's shaman, the olive oil. And isn't it interesting that in other nations, their witch doctors are called shaman?
Or shaman.
Shaman, right. And so you can see there's a lot of relationship to these words with even other nations and their practices of the outward working of their religion, sounds like it even originated a lot of it in Hebrew. Mm-hmm. So the bullock, the second bullock, this is Sheni, which means literally another bullock or a second bullock. It's the number two, I believe. Let me just get this up here where we can see it. And it won't come.
You're coming with me.
Okie dokie, now it's going. So this is the parshani. This is a par is a male bullock, a young bullock. And it says bakar. Bakar.
Herd.
From the beef, cattle, or an animal of the ox family of either gender as used for plowing. Collectively, a herd. A bee, a bull, a calf, a cow, great cattle, heifer, herd, kine, ox. So, like I say, Hebrew is very conceptual. And translating these things often is a little bit difficult. It doesn't make for easy reading, especially when you're translating it. You're trying to make it make sense.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? And sometimes you can't just translate it literally word for word the way it's written in Hebrew, because you end up with something that's more like Koine Greek. Because that's the way they did Koine Greek. It was translated literally, word for word, every time the same way. So you shall take the young bullock for a chatat. What is chat?
Sin.
Sin. Chatat is the sin offering. Verse 9. And you shall bring karav, means to bring close. Karav, to bring near. Karavta, you shall bring to you. He karavta would be causatively. You will cause to be brought near. Okay? Et halivim. This is the sign of the direct object. What are you going to bring near? Et tells us that the next word is what you're going to bring near. The Levite. And you'll bring them before the tabernacle of the appointments. The tabernacle of the appointments. That's the place where we go when we hold our moedim, our appointed seasons. And then it says, well, I'm having a lot of trouble with my, there it is. Vahikahalta. Now, vahikahalta means literally, you will cause to be gathered together. Kahal. Gathered together. It means to convoke or to gather the assembly. A convocation. How many of you have heard me say that one before?
Yes.
Yes. So you shall gather together et kol adat b'nei Yisrael. So the entire assembly of Israel is going to be gathered together. Now keep in mind, all these weeks we've been studying about how they made the various parts of the tent of the meeting and how they put it together, and how they have their duties assigned to the Levites, who's going to be taking care of what. And the Kohanim were assigned their duties by families, and the Levites were supposed to assist them. So now we're putting it all together for the first time. And he's giving these instructions, and you shall gather together, and you shall bring the Levim before Yahweh, and shall put the children of Israel, et yadehim al ha-levi'im. Now, this is something that we call smika. And here it is. Y'all see that?
Yeah.
Smicha. It indicates the laying on of hands. Take hold of in a favorable or unfavorable sense. So they're going to actually take their hands and place them on the Levite. So all the children of Israel are going to lay their hands upon the Levites. Verse 11, and Hanif, and they shall offer, they shall sacrifice a Haran et Halavim. They will sacrifice or offer the Levites to Nofa Lifnei Yahweh, an offering. It's a wave offering before Yahweh. Mayet from the children of Israel, that they may execute the or do the work of the service of Yahweh. So the Levites are going to be working the work of Yahweh. So we're getting the instructions here about putting the Levites to work in the temple and telling what the nature of their work is going to be. Verse 12, and the Levites, Yim, oh, yes, Yisimchu. And again, that's the laying on of hands or grabbing hold of on their hands upon the heads of the bullocks. Rosh HaParim. Par means a bullock. And here there's plural. And you shall offer Echad. What's Echad mean? Anybody?
One.
Chatat. One sin offering. And ha-echad, and the one, ola, a burnt offering. So there's going to be a sin offering and a burnt offering to Yahweh to atone for. Well, my computer just locked up on me, so give me a minute to reopen that up. We've been having a lot of fun tonight, haven't we, with these with these programs. And that's all right. We're just going to keep peacefully going forward, aren't we?
Yep.
Don't you love it when the adversary just can't seem to get you down? I mean, if the whole thing just blew up tonight, I'd just say, okay, well, we'll just finish talking about it.
Amen.
Oh, me. So this is Numbers chapter 8, verse, I think it's 12. Yep. A sin offering for the a burnt an ola offering. The ola means literally cause to ascend up, and that would be like smoke. That's where you catch them on fire. You will make a kafir. What is that?
Covering.
Yom Kippurim. What is that? Day of Atonement, yeah. It's going to be made for and you will set the Levites before and this is interesting. This word here, otam, is a sign of a direct object, including unto them. So it's not with them, but it's to them. And so the offering to them as an offering unto the Lord. So the Levites themselves become an offering unto God. Comment.
You mentioned bringing Levites before Aaron. What about the children of Aaron? Are they also to be brought before them? How's this?
The children of Aaron are the priests.
Well, it depends on the age. It also affects the next.
Three years old and up. It's 7 years and up. Yeah. 3 years and up is for another, it's for the Levites. Those who are able to be a part of the community.
Yeah. Okay.
Taking the census.
Kohen. Other than the rest of the Levites?
Yeah.
Context.
The priesthood is the ones who are the primary orchestra service of Yahweh to the people. And so the rules are different than the rest of the house of those who are ministering and assisting priesthood in the house of Israel. And the house of Israel by the same their service, their instructions, commandments are different from the nations around them. So that not everybody has the same rules to live by. There are certain rules that God just simply won't overlook. And that's the rules which are against the land of Israel, which is his land. Okay, and here's another word for an offer to Yahweh. Tanufa. sacrificial offering. But it's not, this is more of a wave offering here, not not an olah offering and not a mincha or any of the other kinds of offerings that are spelled out in the Torah. But this is tenufah, and the Levites then become a tenufah, an offering to Yahweh. And the tenufah is different because it is a wave offering. And if you look at the definition over here, you'll see it's an offering of shaking, a wave offering.
Oh, yeah. That's so weird.
Isn't it?
How do they wave 22,000 Levites in one day?
The same way we all, wave. Take our hands all together. So the wave offering then something totally as a offering unto God.
So they actually lifted them up somehow?
Oh, no. They might stand them all on a wagon and give it a take. I don't know. But no, I don't think. It says that they were offered as a. In other words, in the was a wave offering that they waved before the Lord. Shavuot, the Levites were a wave of the Lord as well. And so anyway, the wave offering in Shavuot was not an olah offering or a chatat offering. It was a wave offering where the priest would grab the loaves and before the Lord. And the same, the Levites were held to the Lord as a wave offering that they were being dedicated. Service of Yahweh for the house of Israel. Good. You look like you're.
Hi, Dad. Here we are.
So.
Starting to get a little greedy and complaining once again about how they had it all good. Not only that, his fire was kindled, and then knew we prior day stop.
Right. Anger. Steering back, apparently. No problem.
I thought I was
there. Can't you get it on your screen there?
Because it's very, it's
loud. Now you'll know how. He is that was talking to you.
Yeah,
I'm with you, Jane. You know that. I gotta give you a hard time. Nobody.
Oh, come on now.
Well, you got. Admit it now, they were treating you pretty nice. Trophy or something. What the?
Really?
Yeah. I think you over there, Shane. On and I, and that literally means of.
Yes.
After of, or. So, that's why I say the Hebrew is so crucial. Sometimes it's just hard. After, which means sower, yeah. Yahweh, and I'll leave it in. The Levi. Le avod to do the service, the work. Ohel. Direct object and Ohel is the tabernacle of. So it's not really the tabernacle, like they say in the nation, but it's more of the appointments. What are they going to do during the appointed seasons of God? During the holy days, they have responsibilities they have to carry out with the priesthood. Cleanse them. Excuse me, Tanufa. Verse 16. Unim. Let's see what this is. Oh, and that means to get. Okay. Because, it's repeated. That's why they say holy giving. That's not good translating, but that's the best we can come up with.
Oh, presented, okay.
They're given. Hema means literally them unto me. So they are literally given unto Yahweh mitok from the midst of the children of Israel to hot instead. Of tahat can mean the bottom, beneath, this standing again is very conceptual, and it means instead of, which translated it correctly, but that word the word doesn't mean literally instead. Mm-hmm. Instead of heat, as open the womb, the first child out of the womb. Because the firstborn of all the children of Israel. So then, instead of Israel, God's accepting Levites as the sacrifice instead of the He says, look, I have come thee, me, or for me. 17. Ki li ko bikor bivnei, the children of Israel, because mine are all of the firstborn of the children of Israel. But Adam, in the man, who bav hema, and the beast looks like the cattle or whatever, beyom hakoti, in the day that I smote, kol bikor, all of the firstborn. But Eretz Mitzrayim, of the land of Egypt. Hik kashti. And the root there is Kadesh. I sanctified or separated out them unto myself.
Hik kadashti.
That's causatively separating them out. But Ekach, and I have taken et ha-levim, the Levites, tachat, from under kol bikor, or in place of, if you will, all of the firstborn of B'nai Israel, the children of Israel. Now, like it or not, the Levites were chosen by God and sacrificed unto God. The Levites don't have a choice. They have to do the work of God in the temple. They also lose their privileges of inheritance along with the children of Israel. So it sounds like a rotten deal for them, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
But it's actually not, because there are also a lot of benefits that go to the Levites that the other people don't get, such as the tithes and offerings. Special offerings and sacrifices, they get to eat those things.
But they work for them.
Oh, yeah, they worked hard for it. Verse 19, va etna, and that means I have given, et ha-levi'im, the Levites, nitunim, as a gift, they are given to Aaron. And to his sons, mitok, from the midst of B'nai Israel, the children of Israel.
It says it five times in this verse.
I'm sorry?
B'nai Israel is said five times in this one verse.
Right. To do et ha'avodat, the work of B'nai Israel. Be'ochel moed, the service of the children of Israel in the tent of the appointments, hul kafir, to make an atonement for the children of Israel, and not yeh, not be, benim, beni, in the children of Israel, negaf, actually, this is the Segolit, so the first a syllable would be emphasized. Mm-hmm. In fact, the cantoral mark above the nun mm-hmm. tells us that the first syllable is emphasized. And so we, and I'll show you that here. This is the first syllable. It's got that little colon-looking character above the nun. And that's a cantillation mark that tells you that that syllable is emphasized by stretching the vowel sound out longer. So the negaf would be the way to pronounce it. Otherwise, it would be negaf. You'd stretch out the vowel under the gimel.
The sigillet.
A sigillet means that there are two sigils in a row. And because of that, you put the emphasis on the first syllable instead of the last syllable. Most Hebrew words have the emphasis on the second syllable, but in the case of a sigillet, guess where we find another one? Like right here.
Yep.
There's the two sigillets together, and there's negef and geshet. And then the B'nai Yisrael, El unto HaKodesh, the holy, to the holy. It doesn't say sanctuary, but it says holy.
Yep.
Pretty much understood to be the sanctuary, but not very accurate translated. All of this section is so hard to translate that they've had to take a lot of liberties with the translation in order for it to make sense in our language. Okay?
Yep.
So verse 20. And guess what? Our time's almost completely up.
Yep.
Aww. Let's just go to the English. This is what Moses and Aaron and all the community of the people of Israel did to the Levites. The people of Israel acted in accordance with everything that Adonai had ordered Moshe in regard to the Levites. And the Levites purified themselves and washed their clothes. And Aaron offered them as a holy gift before Adonai made atonement for them in order to cleanse them. After that, the Levites came to do their service in the tent of the meeting in front of Aaron. If I can get this thing to first. Okay. And they acted in accordance with Adonai's orders to Moses in regard to the Levi'im. Adonai said to Moses, here are the instructions concerning the Levi'im. When they reach the age of 25, they are to begin performing their duties serving in the tent of the meeting. And when they reach the age of 50, they are to stop performing. When they reach the age of 50, they're to stop performing this work and not serve any longer. They will assist their brothers who are performing their duties in the tent of the meeting, but they themselves will not do any of the work. This is what you are to do with the Levim in regard to their duties. Moses.
There's a hand raised next to me.
Yes.
Interesting that elsewhere it says the Levim shall be shall assume their duties between the ages of 30 and 50. Here it says 25.
Right.
Now we must assume that they're in training at 25.
Probably.
To start at 30.
Adonai spoke to Moshe at the Sinai Desert in the first month of the second year after they had left the land of Egypt. The first month. After they had left the land of Egypt. Second year of journeying. First month American calendar. be probably April. It says, let the people of Israel observe Pesach at its designated time. Where do we find that? Well, in another part of the Torah. The 14th day, observe it, and at dusk is beam, bang. So you got the first for a day and the second day. They actually begins at sunset. The first day. But because he said between the evenings, then you've got to wait until after sacrifice before you sacrifice. In Israel, it's sacrifice a couple days was 3 p.m. So sometime around 3 p.m., that's 3 o'clock in the afternoon, or I guess you could say at the beginning of the third quarter of the day, that would be of the daytime hour, is from sunrise to sunset. Then around 3 p.m. would be where the Passover lambs were sacrificed traditionally. I talked to a rabbi about this, and evenings. Challenged him on that. Well, yes, but it has to be between that 3 p.m. So, I understand they feel that way. And understand why I feel. Yeshua had Passover sunset. That's when they met. Yep. They started the camp while they recitations and the ceremonies concerning Passover. And then that evening, before it got much later, then the would be done, and they could start consuming the lamb and the other items that were instructed. The bitter herbs and things were all to be eaten there at that first. Sometime between the first sunset and the second sunset. After the sunset, after the second sunset is when most of Israel consumes the lamb. It's executed at 3 p.m., brought home, put on the spit, and starting to be slowly roasted. Over then it said it would tell them that you have to be sunrise, but it's to offer the lamb at evening. The first evening is the first thing, Bain Erevim, between evenings. So, on the 14th day of this month, at dusk, you are to observe it. Now, when was Yeshua executed?
Before sunset.
And what time do you think that would be?
3 p.m.
the pastor, our Messiah.
Yes.
And that the lamb is supposed to come. They have them. And historically speaking, it is 3 days. Because it's okay. The lamb was into our house. That be brought into the home, and it's to be examined to see if it's in its body, any sickness. They have to look and see if it's all mutated, because that would be indicating it had some. And so they would look this lamb close, was healthy, and without spot or blemish, carry on the 15th between the 14th. The okay. 14th day is when it's sacrificed, and at 3 p.m. between the evenings, and that's when Messiah Yeshua was executed. What happened to Messiah Yeshua for 3 years, a little more than 3.5 years, prior to his execution? What did they do?
You mean his ministry?
His ministry. What did they do constantly?
Examine him.
They tried to find fault with him, didn't they?
Yeah.
Attempt.
Are you following this?
Yeah.
This is a clear, crystal clear picture of our Messiah.
Yeah.
There's no question about it whatsoever. Isn't that awesome?
Yeah.
So Passover then is a strong picture of the coming of Messiah and the payment that he made for the sins of the world so that they could join in holy union with Almighty God. Awesome. That is amazing. And it's such a strong picture, it's eerie and it gives you goosebumps when you think about it. you are according to all regulations and rules, and Moses told the people of Israel to observe Pesach, so they observed Pesach at dusk between evenings on the 14th day of the month in the Sinai Desert. If you do it at the point in time when all of Israel was doing it, and of course, correct, it's a good time to do it. That's when all Israel would observe it. But in order for Messiah Yeshua to observe it correctly and still be able to let the disciples go, and you know that Peter had a wife. Only here, and so Peter had his wife, he had his children, some aunts and uncles, because he had a big house. Apparently, according to scripture. brother lived on the second floor of his. Today there is a holy Catholic shrine over where his house supposedly was. So we know exactly where it was because of the Catholic shrine over it, you know? But anyway, anything about Messiah. Or his, I will tell you that Messiah was concerned that his disciples could go and experience Passover and discuss these new elements of our faith that he had revealed to them at his Passover with them. And they went out and celebrated it with others who were secretly believers, maybe. And they met together in homes and celebrated Passover together, observing the new understanding of what all these things mean. And I know that they were just as excited and awed by the things that happened as we are. I see this and I'm like, yoo-hoo! You know? And it's really amazing. And so they would have been in the same way. So they observed Pesach at the dusk on the 14th day of the month in the Sinai Desert. And the people of Israel, let's see here if I get this thing to move. There it is. So the people of Israel acted in accordance with all that Yahweh had ordered Moses. And then for certain people, who have become unclean because of someone's. Dead body. They could not observe Passover that day. You have. So came before Moses and Aaron on the. Are unclean because someone, but why must we be kept? Israel. And Moses answered them, so that I can hear what Yahweh will order concerning you. Tell the people of Israel. If any of you or in future generations is on a trip abroad, as he is to observe Pesach, but he will observe it in the second month on the 14th day. So God. Some special arrangements for the 14th of the first special provision for the Passover in the month supposed to be kept to matzah and you're not supposed let off the about and Maror just because in the first month if you're allowed to be unclean state or we were a trip and couldn't barely to leave none of it. Same rules. Shani means second. Pesach second. And they're to observe it according to all the regulations of Pesach. But the person who is clean and not on a trip who fails to observe Pesach will be cut off from his people. That's a big, big penalty right there. And that's why the story of Lazarus and the rich man is so important. Okay.
The bosom of Abraham.
Right. So, to be cut. Oh, excuse me. I was going to talk about the Gehenna for a second. Gehenna is the place supposedly called by the Jewish people the day of the area of punishment. It's like a day of punishment or a time of punishment. And the time of punishment is not like the Christian circles paint it, but rather they are denied burial with their family. So Gehenna then has become understood to be a sign of being cut off from your people. Gehenna was a burial place and the garbage dump of Jerusalem. And of course now it's a beautiful grassy area and students go out and open their books up and study under the shade trees out there in hell. I've been there. Beautiful place. So if Gehenna is hell, it was haphazardly named because it no longer resembles that picture. Okay. And so that if that's the case, then Gehenna is not going to be forever.
True.
So anyway, what can I say? If a foreigner is staying with you and wants to observe Pesach for Adonai, he is to do it according to the regulations and rules of Pesach. You are to have the same law for the foreigner as for the citizen of the land. In other words, to look up the instructions for Pesach, before you can observe Pesach, you have to have circumcision. No uncircumcised person is to keep it, according to the instructions in the Torah.
Right.
Now, why don't we worry about that for today? Well, because there is no kosher Passover today. What? What are you talking about, Rabbi? We have no temple. We're to take the lamb to the temple and have the priest help us oversee its slaughter so we know it's done correctly so that it can be then sacrificed there at the place where God placed his name is what it speaks of in the Torah. And so you have to take it to the city of Jerusalem with the priesthood and slaughter the lamb there, and then you observe the Passover in your homes with the Passover rotisserie and observe Passover. But the problem is we have no priesthood, we have no altar, we have no place to sacrifice the lambs, so therefore we cannot keep Passover according to the Torah's instructions. Nowhere on earth can the Passover be properly, kosherly observed. Nowhere. So what do? We hold a memorial. It's only a memorial. I'm not really all that worried about holding the Passover on the exact day that it's supposed to be observed on. I've had people argue with me, but it's supposed to be on this day because in Jerusalem, this is the 14th, but here we're outside of the 14th. That is a bunch of malarkey because nobody's able to keep it correctly anyway. All we're holding is a memorial of it. And so, consequently, if I hold it on the 14th or on the 15th, it makes no difference. And if it's 14th here or the 15th here or the 14th there or the 15th there, it makes no difference. We can't even honor it. We can't honor God in the way it's prescribed at the place where he placed his name. So what do? We do the best we can do, and we ask God to accept it as suitable. And that's what we did this year for Passover, isn't it?
It was a phenomenal.
I agree with you, Shane. It was a phenomenal Passover. And the Spirit of the Lord was here, and everybody came into the place, and they were all excited.
Yes.
And all the food was like supernaturally imperfect, supernaturally perfection.
Yes.
It was supernatural. The whole thing.
Yeah.
So I agree with you, Shane. That was a phenomenal Passover. And it was only a memorial, but God anointed it.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah is right. I can't wait for the next one because that lamb is delicious. It says...
after Rosh Hashanah, we do have Sukkot. It's
I'm sorry?
We do have Sukkot, Omni Etzeret.
Shemini Etzeret.
Shemini Etzeret.
What does Shemini Etzeret mean?
It's
eighth great day.
He got ahead of me.
The eighth great day.
Eighth day of gathering. Etzeret means gathering, assembly. So it's the eighth day of assembly. The seventh day would be what's called Hoshana Rabbah in Hebrew. And you know, I'm already 15 minutes over on my time.
Nonsense.
But
we're not tracking a clock.
We started late.
Yeah, we had a little problem getting this thing started. But I think we need to call this good enough. But there's a lot more in this week. It talks about the Spirit of God. And the column of fire and the column of smoke that guided people of Israel through the wilderness into their promised land. It's amazing stories. And this is where those began to take place, where the cloud would lift off of the tent of the meeting and move forward, and then the whole people would know it's time for them to pack their tents and get going on the road.
And then the following verse we see a very spiritual concept of Adonai instructing the Moshe to delegate the burden, the feeling of the entire people, over to the different heads of the tribes. And you're seeing a spirit come upon them and they prophesy.
Yep.
There's
That's
a very
right.
deep, there's some very deep spiritual concepts there of not only Rakia, but also concepts that we teach in regards to becoming aware of when we're carrying the burdens of other people.
That's right. You're going to make a fine rabbi.
There it is. You just heard it from his lips.
Just keep studying.
That's okay? Key.
Mama's back there glowing. I see it. Just keep on the track.
Okay.
Well, that's about the sum and size of it. So I guess we'll call that good for tonight. I would like to invite all of you watching online to come and worship with us on Shabbat. We have a 10 o'clock morning class on Saturday. I teach a class called Bible Issues, and I've been told it is some of the meatiest teaching on planet Earth. I suppose that's true. I hope so anyway. And then at 11 o'clock is our morning service. We finish up around 1 o'clock. And then next week on Tuesday, we will be back here. Now, I got a little piece of news for you. On Sunday at 4 p.m., we will be holding our first broadcast, weekly broadcast, on radio. And our first set of teachings is going to be on the holy days and their relationship to the Messiah.
Phenomenal.
Isn't that good?
Yes.
So tell all your friends and come and listen with us. And if Shane's available, I'd like you to come and help us out.
I will be available.
And that'll be a lot of fun. And I just think that we're going to have a wonderful time. Now, we don't have enough room in the studio for you to be able to come and just have a bunch of people come and sit in our studio. So you'll just have to listen on the radio. But some of you may want to call in with questions that you know you wanted answered. You know, if we open up the phone lines, then you'll be able to help kind of usher in some phone conversations. And a lot of people are a little shaky about calling in until they see somebody else do it and see how they're treated. Then maybe they'll call too.
Yep.
But we're going to have a good time on Sunday. This coming Sunday, 4 p.m., be there or be square, you know what I mean?
Absolutely.
So I hope to see all of you, not only online, but on the radio.
Hallelujah.
So we will call that good for tonight. Yes, sir?
Tell them where to find it.
Oh, that's here in Austin in the area. It's multi-counties around. All the counties around us should be able to get the broadcast. And it's 11:20 a.m., the Bridge Radio. They don't usually use their call letters, so just look for the Bridge Radio. It's also available online, so those of you who are out in Never Never Land, if you want to watch it, you can tune into the internet.
And what's see that website?
And it's the Bridge. Just Google the Bridge, and it'll tell you where it's at.
Bridge.net.org or .com.
I don't know. Don't get me lying. I told you to look it up on the internet. So there you go. Just look at the bridge in Austin, Texas, and you'll find it.
Look for the bridge, 11:20 a.m.
Yeah, the bridge, 11:20 a.m.
I'll get that out there.
So anyway, if you, no matter where you're at, if you've got internet, you can watch it. So
awesome.
It's not a problem.
We'll okay? Make that.
In the meantime, this is our first
all
radio
right.
broadcast will be this Sunday
right.
at 4 p.m. from 4 to 5 p.m.
Central time.
Come and join us, and we will have fun till your daddy takes your T-Bird away.
You're excited.
I am excited.
Is that one of those previous generation
yeah.
ones?
Okay. Beach Boys.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, good night, you all. Come again and see us on Shabbat and again on next Tuesday. And please, if you can, tune in on the bridge, 11:20 a.m., 4 p.m. on Sunday, and I'll see you there. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Be there or beware.
Be there or be square. You know what I mean?
And